warm welcome, everybody. Good to see you all. Welcome to this second dialogue between Dr. Mark Guffey and Andrew Cohen about evolutionary spirituality. They started this new series a few weeks ago, and today the topic is evolutionary relationships. So welcome to all of you. Welcome, Mark. Welcome, Andrew. Very exciting to be all together again, and I'm very curious to hear the dialogue today. So Andrew Cohen is a spiritual teacher, author, cultural visionary, and inspirational speaker. His work has been acclaimed by luminaries worldwide, from academics to philosophers to teachers of all faiths and none. From 1991 to 2010, he was editor-in-chief of the award-winning Enlightened Next magazine, a widely cherished publication that explored the deepest existential questions of our time with some of the world's most noted thought leaders. Andrew has become known for his willingness to boldly cast aside the sacred cows of the spiritual world. His work grapples with demystifying the wealth of knowledge found in the great wisdom traditions and with making enlightenment deeply relevant to a postmodern audience. In 2020, he and a small group of collaborators launched the online project Manifest Nirvana, a virtual ashram and monastery of the future, which Andrew has called a home for sovereign souls, radical spirits, and integral pioneers. In his 3 decades of teaching and lecturing, he has developed a unique and powerful vision for a truly contemporary spirituality, combining evolutionary theory and integral developmental practice with the timeless wisdom of the perennial philosophy. Departing radically from a traditional Eastern approach, Andrew's pioneering Dharma evolutionary enlightenment calls not for transcendence of the world, but for a deep and heroic responsibility for its evolution. And with that, Krista, I hand over to you.
Yes, thank you, Daniela. It is my honor to introduce to you Dr. Mark Guffey. Dr. Mark Guffey is a leading public intellectual and teacher impacting the source code of global culture. Guffey is a visionary thinker, a social activist, and a passionate philosopher. He is known for his source code teachings, including unique self theory and the 5 selves, the amorous cosmos, a politics of evolutionary love, a return to eros, and digital intimacy. He is author of 25 books, of which the first 10 have been published, including the award-winning Your Unique Self, The Radical Path to Personal Enlightenment. He holds his doctorate in philosophy from Oxford University, as well as Orthodox rabbinic ordination. He teaches on the cutting edge of philosophy and spirit in the West with the aim of participating in the articulation of what Dr. Guffey, together with Dr. Zach Stein and colleagues, are calling a cosmo-erotic humanism. At the core of cosmo-erotic humanism is what Dr. Guffey and Dr. Stein are calling first principles and first values, anthro-ontology, and a universal grammar of value. This is the ground of a new shared universe story and narrative of identity for the new human and the new humanity. This is what they are calling the emergence from Homo sapiens to Homo amor. This shared story, rooted in these first principles and first values, can then serve as the matrix for a global ethos, for a global civilization. Together with Ken Wilber and Sally Kempton, Mark Guffey is the co-founder of the Center for Integral Wisdom. Together with Dr. Zach Stein, he serves as its co-president, co-leading a team of thinkers articulating this new vision of meaning for the world. He's a co-founder with Ken Wilber and Sally Kempton of the Center for Integral Wisdom, where he serves. The previous chairs of the center include Barbara Marx Hubbard, Laurie Galprin, John P. Mackey, Kerry Kish, and Adam Bellow. And our current chairs are Sharif Melnick and Gabrielle Anwar. Mark also served as the co chair together with Barbara Marx Hubbard and now as director of the Foundation for Conscious Evolution. Together with the late Barbara Marx Hubbard, he co-founded One Mountain, Many Paths, a global communion of pioneering souls committed to articulate first principles and first values, a new story for a new humanity. Or as Mark and Barbara said it together, a planetary awakening in love through unique self symphonies. All of these movements have recently come together under the Office for the Future, initiated by Barbara Marx Hubbard, Dr. Gaffney, Dr. Stein, and the visionary leadership of partners from around the world. And with that, I turn my word to you, Dr. Mark Gaffney.
Thank you. Thank you. So welcome, everyone. It is fabulous to be with you. I want to find Andrew, who I can't find on my screen. So let me just see if I can do that for a second. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. So I'm just trying to think, there you are, brother. Okay, there you are. Okay, fantastic. I just wanted to find you there. Okay, there we are. Okay, fantastic. It's great to see you. So let me just share with everyone a little bit, where I am in relationship right now, because it's a little bit of an unusual moment. So just, I want to do a little full disclosure and then I'm going to duck in. So I'm in a slightly unusual position in which I just flew last night. And this is what we're going to do is really enter into relationship right now, because our topic is relationships. So this is actually the core of what I want to say about relationship. And the core of relationship and everything I want to kind of talk about today, and Andrew will talk about in his gorgeous way, is about, can we feel each other? That's actually what relationship's about. Relationship is about not I relate to you as an object, but can we actually feel each other? The capacity not just to interact, not just to be it, there's an I and there's an it, not just to be instrumental, but to actually shift perspectives. Relationship means, can I see the world through your eyes? Can I feel the world through your joy and through your pain? And that goes for the inception of relationship, which is infinity talking to finitude, divinity talking to the human being, where God says to the human being, God, the infinity of intimacy. Isn't that beautiful? Right? God's not just the infinity of power, God's the infinity of intimacy. And God says, I want to be so intimate with you that I want to feel you. And I want to be so intimate with you that I desperately want you to feel me. Right? And that's called, in the nomenclature of interior wisdom, that's called Imo Anochi Bitsara. Isaiah, the great enlightened masters, I'm with you in your pain. I'm with you in your joy. I'm with you in your triumph. You know, there's a certain kind of friend who's with us when it's all going well. There's another kind of friend who kind of really sticks around even when it's hard. It's very rare, says Zushi of Anipol, a great Hasidic master, that you have a friend who can actually feel your joy with you. In your triumph, right? To feel each other, right, is everything, and it's the essence of enlightenment. So I want to just, in line with that, because that's going to be our topic, I want to share with you, I had a judgment call to make about whether to do this dialogue or not. I just left Miami yesterday to came to visit my dear friend, who's actually wasn't feeling so great the last couple of weeks, Sally Kempton. She's one of the great teachers of Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta and Kashmir Shaivism. She is very careful about COVID, so I came to a hotel instead of to her house to do it the three-day quarantine, right? And on the way to the airport, I'll just give you the scene. I'm leaving the Ritz-Carlton in Florida yesterday, and I see the person who's supposed to put all my bags in the car. And my bags means a lot of books. Right? It's a lot of books. And I know they're online, But I need, you know, 30, 40 sacred texts around in order to travel, because how can a person travel without 30, 40 sacred texts? I can't even figure it out. So the guy who is driving the Lyft, there's Uber and Lyft in America, it was a Lyft. The guy who's driving the Lyft was kind of beautiful, but old and frail. And he was going to go try and deal with my suitcases. And I just said, oh my God, that's a disaster. I said, no, I got it covered. He said, no, I'll help you. I said, I just saw there's no way he's going to be able to help me. So I picked up this huge suitcase of books. Okay, do we have a drum roll in the house? We have empathy coming. Are we ready? Let's get a little empathy coming. Jorge, you can give me a little empathy there? Okay, Jorge's looking at something like, what is this guy talking about? Give me a little empathy here. Okay, here we go. Ready? Here we go, brother. So I lift up. You know how you kind of put something in the trunk? You kind of lift it up, and my back went boom, right? So now I've got an entire day of flying, right? I'm in, I would say, relative agony. Not extreme agony. Is that a good level? Trying to feel each other? Relative agony. But I have three flights. I've got like four more bags with me. You got to put them up and take them down, put them up and take them down. So I sort of bumbled through that, got to the hotel and thought, okay, it's going to be okay. I got this covered. And then I made a mistake. I looked up online. I didn't want to bother Sally. And it said, okay, put ice on your back. And how's everybody doing here on empathy? About relationship here. How are we doing on empathy? Just checking in, okay? Everyone doing okay? I don't see any tears yet. Nothing, no tears, no nothing, no. No, all right, well, I can tell you a little more, okay? So I put ice on my back, right? And getting the ice was like a thing because I literally couldn't move. I put the ice on my back. I fell asleep with the ice on my back, and I woke up in unbearable agony. Ice was the wrong move. I literally couldn't move anything, right? And so from there till now, I've had a very long night where I've tried to figure out how to sleep. And every position I thought sleeping worked for about 20 minutes, right? And then didn't work anymore. Now, you might ask, why didn't you cancel the dialogue? Because I thought I could do it. So I still think we can. So I found a perfect position to be in. They actually brought me a chair from the front desk. You see my bed back there, just so you know my story is true. We're in the hotel room there. Okay, we're at the Carmel Mission Inn, right? Anyone wants to come by who's like a massage therapist, you're completely welcome. And I'm madly excited to be doing this dialogue with my dear, dear friend, Andrew. And I think that these dialogues are so important. And I know that, many, many hundreds of people signed up. And I thought, it's relationships about feeling each other. We can do this. Okay? So that's my confession at the beginning. So I may get up a couple of times just to stretch my back, and I'll be completely listening to Andrew, which I always do with great delight. But now you guys got a little bit of the map. Okay, so I'm gonna look in the chat box here. I know you guys are not big chat box people. I'm just checking, do I have any empathy in this chat box? I'm checking in the chat box. Chat box people, hello,
Mark,
anybody?
Mark, the chat box is not open for public chatting.
Oh my God, no empathy in the chat box, I forgot. Okay, that's
total,
okay.
Total empathy.
All right, okay, we got total empathy. Thank you, Daniela, without the chat box. Okay, fantastic. Okay, yay. All right, so we ready to go, everybody? We're ready to go? Okay, here we go. So I'm supposed to start today, which I've already done. I'm just going to do a couple of more minutes. I'm going to pass to Andrew, and I'm actually madly excited about this topic. By the way, I will just say one last thing, we're just going to up the empathy one. I did call up my local doctor, my old friend here, and he told me, he said, that much pain, go to the emergency room. So you are my emergency room. Ready, guys? Here we go. Okay. So I want to set up a couple of principles, then weave in what I said. I'm going to be just not more than 5-6 minutes now, and then pass to Andrew. And it's a madly exciting conversation. So relationship is not simply in the realm of the relative. Does everyone get this? In other words, in much of Eastern thought and in certain strains, right, of Western mysticism, we say relationships in the world of the relative. Does everyone know what I mean by the relative? Meaning that's the manifest. But the absolute, right? Don't use your hands that way, Mark, that affects your back. The absolute right? The absolute is a whole different world. The absolute is pure, unmanifest consciousness, which lives in you. And the goal of being alive is to fully identify and realize your true identity as pure, unmanifest consciousness awake and alive in you. That notion is precisely what I want to take issue with. That actually, it's not just that good relationship is a precondition for enlightenment, as in the Buddhist Eightfold Path. It's not just that enlightenment affects relationship, number two, but actually in evolutionary spirituality, what we actually understand, and this is our second topic, evolutionary relationships, that actually relationship is enlightenment and enlightenment is relationship. There's no split between them. Number one, and I'm gonna try and create a schematic here. Number two, relationship is a first principle and first value of reality. It's not a social construction. And on the subject of relationship, I see Don Pett. It's great to see you. Yay, fantastic. Awesome, right? So relationship is not a social construction of reality. Relationship is a first principle and first value of reality itself, which means, let me see what that means. That means that relationship lives in reality all the way down and all the way up the evolutionary chain. So let's see if we can unpack that. Number three. One, what incepts reality? Why are we here? Or why are we here? Why are we talking? We're talking because infinity desired relationship. Right? That's why we're here. I mean, infinite consciousness said consciousness is not enough. Isn't that exciting? I mean, it's wild. Infinity itself desired relationship with finitude. I mean, that's shocking. Infinity was pretty enlightened. It had gone to a whole bunch of incredible seminars, got major enlightenment transmission, was completely awake, utter consciousness, and Infinity said, no. I'm perfection. I'm perfect consciousness. And not I am that I am. That's not written anyplace. That's utter nonsense quoted by enlightenment teachers. It's nonsense. That's not what the verse says. It's a verse in Exodus which says, I will be what I will be. I will be what I will be, meaning I evolve in relationship. And then, right, Western teachers retranslated that as I am that I am, but it's actually not what the verse says, right? Beginning of Exodus, right? I will be what I will be, and I will evolve with you in relationship. So reality exists because infinity desires relationship with finity. The infinity of all manifests a particular quality. Abhinavagupta and Kashmir Shaivam talks about a stirring of desire in the infinite at the highest tattvas, right? So infinity desires relationship. And infinity desires relationship with who? With us. So one. Reality is incepted because infinity desires relationship. Number two, once we're in manifest reality, and I'm just going to finish setting this up and then turn to Andrew, but I want to offer this as a framework for the conversation. Number two, once the manifest exists, the manifest has three principles. And this is stunningly exciting, and it changes how we view all of the world. One, reality is relationship. Principle one. Principle two, reality is evolution. Not I am that I am, I will be what I will be. So principle two is reality is evolution. Three, well, let's call it 2A. 2A, evolution is a series of transformations. That's what evolution is. It's a series of transformations. So reality is relationship, one. Two, reality is evolution. 2A, right, evolution is a series of transformations. Three, reality is the evolution of relationships. Isn't that gorgeous? Reality is evolution. Reality is relationship. Reality is the evolution of relationships. Reality is manifested, incepted, because infinite consciousness feels inadequate. Or let me use a term from the sacred text more carefully. Imperfect. perfection feels imperfect until perfection enters relationship. Okay, that's a big frame. That's a big deal. I am. There's no place I'd rather be than talking to my colleague and dharmic interlocutor and dear friend Andrew, right, about this topic. There's no topic that's more important, right? Because relationship is everything, and how we do it and what it means. So with mad delight, I turn to Andrew.
The most profound thing anyone ever said to me about the nature of relationship was my guru, shortly after I met him. And I hadn't seen him for a while, and when I walked in the room, and he was sitting on his bed, and he looked at me and he said, "Andrew, I'm so glad you found a friend you'll never be able to see." He said, "I'm so glad you found a friend you'll never be able to see," and it took me a while to understand what he meant. But the deepest relationship, which is not a relationship, the deepest relationship, which is not a relationship, the deepest source of intimacy that I experienced, as you were speaking about, the experience in the presence of inconceivable intimacy, which is the nature of God and nature of the Absolute, is in a context of non-duality, is our dearest, most intimate connection with reality, with life, in which there is no duality. So when we pray or when we meditate, we are seeking to realize and experience a relationship in which there is only one and not two. And that's the source of ultimate and perfect liberation. I agree with you that God of the Absolute Principle who is the essence of perfection and completeness in himself and herself created the manifest universe, I believe, and this is my speculative mystical inquiry, I believe that God created the universe because she could. Because I think that she existed eternally for eternity in perfect happiness and perfect contentment. And I think at a certain point she became curious. I wonder what it would be like to do something very big. And if you were God, what's the biggest thing you could possibly do? The biggest thing you could possibly do if you were God would be to create a universe or a multiverse. And it's in my speculative metaphysical inquiry, I can through an anthropomorphic intuitive speculation, I can relate to the fact that if I existed eternally for eternity in perfect happiness, I might get curious and had been doing absolutely nothing whatsoever forever. At a certain point, I might become curious about what it might be like to do something. What's the biggest thing I could possibly do would be to create a universe or a multiverse. And then I would build up the creative tension, creative inspiration over countless billions of eons of no time until that curiosity burst forth ecstatically into the evolving universe. And then, of course, and that's when this whole issue of relationship entered into reality. Mm-hmm. The one became the many. Mm-hmm. Now, what I wanted to speak about evolutionary relationships a little bit, since this is where our topic is, and I wanted to try and make some distinctions. So, for example, I agree with you that there's different kinds of human relationships, and I'd love to talk to you about those different kinds of relationships.
Yeah.
But there's different reasons that human beings are together in relationships. We come together for all kinds of reasons. And we're not always together, we're not always in relationship for the same reason. Some reasons are very wholesome, some reasons are very unwholesome, some are very positive, some are very negative. But the reasons we enter into relationships are very different. I need all your attention, brother.
You know, sweetheart, I'm taking little notes on what you're saying, so I won't be able to share and response. You got me all the way. Okay.
Okay.
A couple of minutes.
Okay. So
right? Right? I mean, that's it right there, right? In other words, I need your, that's the whole thing, right? It's all in that place. Yeah, totally.
So evolutionary relationships are unique in context. The context of an evolutionary relationship, which is what we're speaking about here, is absolutely and radically unique in the human experience. So an evolutionary relationship is about going on a journey, and it's a journey that has a particular destination with another or with others. For example, if you're an astronaut and you have a relationship with your co-pilot who's going to the moon or going to Mars, going somewhere, the context of your relationship is your journey to Mars and what you intend to accomplish there. An evolutionary relationship, the context of an evolutionary relationship is the activation and manifestation of the evolutionary impulse consciously engaged with in a context of committed relatedness or committed relationship. An evolutionary relationship is about going on a journey with the other or the others. And this journey is usually driven by utopian aspirations. It's driven by spiritually inspired, spiritually realized utopian aspirations. It comes from the realization that the universe can be so much more beautiful than it already is if we find ways to love each other for deeper reasons, and if we endeavor to make manifest the highest truth of love that we realize in the way we relate to each other. But the important thing here is that an evolutionary relationship is about being on a journey with the other or the others to the highest realization of love, oneness, non-duality, peace, and shared creativity that is conceivable within the context of known reality. And that's kind of what we want to do with each other. Another interesting context where relationships are very, very different is when, for example, if you're a Navy SEAL, your relationship with your other Navy SEAL brothers, it's all about the mission. It's not personal. It's about the mission and the mission in the context of our personal experience of relatedness and relationship. It's recontextualized always by the mission, the mission, the mission. So the mission in an evolutionary context is to make manifest the most profound and unthinkably beautiful aspirations of God Himself. And it's a journey that has no end to it. There's no end to what the Absolute is capable of. So it's an infinite journey to infinite possibility. And when human beings come together in the context of an infinite journey to infinite possibility, the way they relate to each other, the way they speak, the way they share their emotional experience, the way they work together, the way they think, is very unique and very different than any other kind of relationship. So it's a committed, spiritually charged relationship that is on the most profound creative journey that's possible to imagine, and it is imbued with the purest kind of positive intentions and motivations. And it's not about arriving anywhere. It's about being on the journey, because ultimately, if God is infinite, then there's no end to her creative potential. So if we come together in a shared mission to give rise to her greatest gifts, we're saying yes to an infinite journey of inconceivable, unleashing and giving rise to unthinkable creative potential, eternally for eternity, together forever. So that's how I would define an evolutionary relationship. And just to finish in response to what you said about in your response to Eastern mysticism, I think that the realization of this cosmocentric orientation to relationship and to relatedness changes dramatically and makes profound and unimaginable ways the way we relate to each other on a personal level. Because even though life is personal. So people sometimes say it's not personal. It's very personal. It's very personal. When we awaken to the evolutionary impulse and experience that evolutionary momentum coming alive to itself and itself within us, we experience this sense of what we're calling personal begin to expand into all directions and to include ultimately the whole universe. We realize we're not separate from the whole universe that's on that journey, and we're a small part of it that has gained and inherited the gift of self-reflective awareness, in which this entire process can bear witness to itself in the most extraordinary, as you would say, gorgeous way. And so when we can bear witness to ourselves becoming conscious of this journey we're on and then endeavoring to spiritually take responsibility for the whole process, that's a spiritual life lived in earnest.
Yeah, gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous. So there's so much that you said there that was so important. And I want to try, and if I can, now we're going to stay real close together. I want to try and split what you said into two and actually engage both parts in a great conversation. Okay, because I think these are critical, you know, and you can't talk about an evolutionary spirituality without revisioning relationship.
Correct.
Right, and relationship doesn't make sense, as you're implying, outside the context of a universe story and a story of identity, right? And as if I don't have a universe story and I don't have a story of who I am, right, then we can't talk about who are we. So in other words, if I had to kind of frame it in the largest frame, I would say it like this, Andrew. I would say, you know, there's three great questions. I sometimes call them, just when I'm, you know, and we're doing some writing now with Zach, call them the three great questions of cosmorotic humanism. But you know, there's lots of ways to talk about it. But the questions are, where are we, right? Who are we? And what's there to do, right? So where, who, and what, right? You know, where are we? What kind of universe are we living in? Who are we in the universe? What's there to do? And which, of course, the next question is then, or part of who are you, however you want to list it, is who are we? But who are we? It can't stand, as you implied very beautifully, and that was all implicit in everything you said, especially the second part, right? Which is we need to have that larger context. Without that, you can't actually address relationship, and that was implicit in everything you said, so I want to just explicate that, so that's one. But now I want to kind of split between two things that you talked about, first and second. The first is the motivation, right, of the manifest world, right? Why'd she do it? Why'd he do it? Why did infinite consciousness, right? You know, and you presented as a metaphysical speculation a kind of very beautiful version of Leela, right? Of, right, you know, that notion of, you know, this kind of divine curiosity, this kind of, you know, divine play, which is very, very strong in, you know, I mean, you and I have, you know, talked and studied and lived this in practice for many years, very, very strong in Vedanta, right? There's an element of it in Kabbalah. Kabbalah calls it Shashua, right? The divine play. Right, which is, you know, similar to Leela. But I think that the way that's presented, I always had trouble with. I think it's problematic. And it's worth talking about for a second before we get to part two, which is when we
I
think...
Agree, I agree with you. I mean, I just interject just briefly. I think that the problem I have with the Leela concept is that it can lead us towards nihilism because it doesn't give light to the extraordinary sense of purpose and intention behind the creator.
That's right. And that exactly. So in that metaphysical speculation of Leela that you unfolded, right, I would respond, right, exactly with what you just said, which is the problem with Leela and the problem with divine curiosity, right, is that it leaves out this, you know, utter intentionality of cosmos. Right, this utter purpose, and leaves human beings, right, as the product of some kind of arbitrary divine curiosity, which is a very hard way to explain a Holocaust, right? Right, in other words, I mean, you know, right, the intensity and the pain and the ecstasy and the joy and the gravitas, right, of the human experience. Right. So I think that's, you know, I think that's enormously problematic, and I agree with you. I think that we need to actually recognize, you know, that dimension of purpose and that dimension of telos. Well, at the same time, and here's where we can reintegrate and this is very subtle. I mean, we actually have this conversation, you know, everyone, we got to be on the inside of the inside and to actually feel in realization what the highest experience of curiosity is. What's the highest experience of play, right? In other words, curiosity at its core, right, is the, and I want to speak now in terms of realization, curiosity at its core is the opening gate to love, right? In other words, when I stop being curious about you, I stop loving you, right? And as you can actually tell, right? And it's when you stop being curious about your beloved, you know that love is wilting and waning and dying, right? One of the demarcating characteristics of this awakening from our kind of separate self torporitic slumber, right, into a kind of genuine sense of presence is I'm curious. And I'm curious about life. I'm curious about you. And I'm curious about knowing more about me. I'm right curious. So curiosity is actually the gateway. It's the curiosity is the foreplay of love, or the foreplay of love, if you want to say, right? It's like it's how I so I think that sense of curiosity that both Vedanta talks about, right, and the Kabbalists talk about, which then leads divinity to a kind of play, is not the play that we think about play. I think that when we talk about it, it kind of gets lost. It's play as the ultimate gravitas, right? The ultimate seriousness, right? There's a place in which play and purpose become one. But play doesn't mean frivolous, right? Play doesn't mean casual. Play is this energized, fully alive, you know, eros infused, right? Desperate search for ultimate expression, right? So that's what they mean by play, by Shashua. So in that sense, and that's
let me
please.
Just to agree with you,
please.
That when we awaken to this evolutionary process, when it's genuine, we awaken to a moral imperative. We realize inherent in the awakening to Eros, this creative process that is intelligent and on a mission. Our seeing it, when we see it, it sees us. And,
right.
And that's like a moment of being baptized or initiated, and then we can't forget after that happens what that means about us and about our lives and the choices we're making, the actions we're taking, and what our motivations are. It's absolutely transformative.
Yeah, right.
The moral imperative is the gravitas you're talking about.
Right. Absolutely, brother. Right. Another. It's a moral imperative, and this is what you were trying pointing towards, that metaphysical speculation that kind of came out of Leela. And this is the paradox, this is the beauty, and there's this place at the higher level of consciousness where the tension of contradiction gives way and melts into paradox, right? And I'm actually kind of in a little bit, because of the intensity of the pain, I'm a little bit of an altered state, so I'm speaking from within just the feeling of the realization of it, right? In other words, we think of a kind of contradiction between, let's say, choosing and not choosing. Right? Or do we choose, or is it all destined? Is it all laid out? So in the third century, the great master said, Hakol Tsafui, all is seen, Varashut Netuna, and permission is given. Mm-hmm. And of course, they're talking paradox, right? In other words, the split between did I choose and I didn't choose at the highest level of consciousness becomes choicelessness, right? In other words, it's, right, it disappears, right? I'm lived by reality, I'm fully choosing, and it couldn't have been any different. In the same sense, and tell me how this feels for you, brother, right? The split at the highest levels between the utter gravitas of telos, of direction, right? Of ultimate purpose, of mission, right? Right? And ultimate curiosity and play actually merge into one, right? They actually become one. And that's how Cook kind of subtly, if you read him carefully 1,000 times, he's working for that. Cook, the evolutionary mystic writing in the 20th century, right? We're kind of ultimate play and ultimate seriousness, ultimate gravitas and ultimate, you know, this kind of open play actually are completely indistinct from each other. They're a full realization. So I think that's where we begin to get a sense of that. How does that feel to you?
It feels beautiful and wonderful and perfect. And to continue along with this theme, that the implications for a relationship are very profound.
Yes.
This is the conscious context in which we are relating to each other.
Right.
There are implications, there are obligations, and it means I can't do anything I want to do whenever I want to do it because I feel like it. Means if I'm going to live up to my spiritual realization of Eros, I have to be true to that spiritual realization in the context of the way I relate to you and the way you relate to me.
Right, and
it has a dramatic effect on the meaning of relationship.
Everything, right? So and at the same time, we're in mad joy together, right? You know, Daniela introduced me as Elka. She said, you know, but I'm really Mark. But an Andrew and Elka, let's just bring Elka in, right? Or Christina, right? Or an Andrew and Mark, right? There's actually love and Eros in play. Right? It's not just, oh, you know, it's not only the imperative, the urgent moral imperative of responding to existential risk and articulating a new source code, which is what we're here to do, to articulate and put evolutionary spirituality, because it's desperately needed to actually live alive and to actually respond to, you know, a kind of looming suffering that's unimaginable, right? It's all of that, and it's the utter delight of talking together, right? It's the utter delight of the play together, and they live together, right? And they don't, and at some sense, they're ultimately non-separate. I'll just give you the last example, I'll turn back to you, and then we'll get to the second part of what you said, but let's just go back and forth, and we'll get to part two. But, you know, I think I might have mentioned in one of our dialogues, you know, my dear friend Sally Kempton, that I flew out to see her father, Murray Kempton, was one of the great American writers. You know, he wrote a column every day for 40 years, and was kind of the kind of king of liberal letters in America. He studied in all the various journalism schools. So when Sally would ask him, like, what was the most wonderful time of your life, he would talk about, and you mentioned this earlier, right, this image, he would talk about when he was in the Pacific Theater, right, in World War II, where he was with a bunch of guys, and they were involved in complete mission. I mean, their lives were on the line every second. Boys were being, right, I mean, killed around them, at the most serious, the worst place you'd ever want to be, and none of them wanted to be there. And yet, when he looks back at his life, his experience kind of, there's actually a period of joy. There was a joy in it because, and there was, and again, I'm going to be very careful with this word. When I say play, I don't mean anything frivolous, right? That's, I'm saying only in a different state of consciousness can you even, you know, feel this word. But there was a sense of like every move mattered. There was nothing that was insignificant. And even the casual joke, right, exchanged between guys, you know, in whatever that version of a foxhole was, resonated in eternity. It was the laughter of the divine, right? And so there's this sense of, you know, of actually the breath of infinity, right, breathes into, right, the pulsing of finitude, and there's no split, and you're in ultimate play and ultimate seriousness, and everything's on the line in every second, and that's like that.
Well, that's a beautiful example, and I've used that myself very often, and why those soldiers were having that particular depth of intimacy, while they were sharing the depth of intimacy, is because they were assuming the ultimate spiritual position, which is they were 100% committed.
Right, 100% committed.
So there was no ambivalence about where they were, what they were doing, or their relationship to each other. There was a full commitment. I'm all in.
Right.
And there's no doubt, and I've got your back, and you've got my back.
Right.
And we all know we're facing the ultimate test. We all know this is a matter of life and death. And there's a moral context in war, which is in this case it's always the good guys fighting the bad guys. So there's an absolute moral precedent. There's an absolute commitment to victory, even if one's going to lose one's life, one is completely and fully committed. So one of the things that I used to say to my students is I wish I would describe this the similar scenario that you did that we're speaking about. What if we all could care about the evolution of consciousness,
right,
as much as soldiers on the battlefield feel about completing their mission?
Yeah, no. So, beautiful.
Because in terms of the depth of human relationship and relatedness, I think that kind of commitment and that kind of willingness to really, it's the realization that I need to be true. I need to be authentic if love is going to mean anything. And so what I wanted to add to what you said earlier is that, because you responded by saying, well, but this is really about joy. It's about sharing incredible joy. And I think that that God gives
incredible joy and incredible pain, right? Everything. Yeah.
Sure. Yes, absolutely. And compassion. But to focus a little bit on the joy for a moment, God's giving us all an opportunity to experience unimaginable joy in the way we love each other and the feeling of being connected to each other. But I think that's dependent upon Dharma. It depends upon us living up to dharmic principles, moral principles that we have agreed are more important than anything else. And when we agree on those principles, you call them first principles, when we agree on these dharmic principles, and we vow in all our imperfection to do our best to live up to them with all we've got, knowing we're going to fail, but the willingness to do anything and everything we can to do so, if we both do that together with an attitude of being utterly earnest and transparent and authentic, the joy between us will well up and become overwhelming time and time again. But there's a relationship between the emergence and the experience of joy and the fact that the Dharma commands us, compels us to live a life of deep integrity, to live life in integrity, with deep integrity. And it's not for our own sake, it's for the sake of the truth as we realize it when we wake up. So if we can do that, then the beautiful thing is if we can live in alignment with the Dharma, or the ultimate truth of all the greatest religious traditions, we can experience a depth of joy in our relationship with life and with our maker, but also with each other, that it's incomparable to any other kind of joy. But it's not free, because we have to live in accordance with the truth.
Yeah, so that's beautiful. So let's unfold a couple of things here, and then I want to get back to, you know, the core to evolutionary relationships. But there's a couple of things that are on the table, and then we'll get back to evolutionary relationships, which is of course the core of what we're talking about, which is, you know, and I want to kind of drop into this. There's no intimacy without shared story, right? In other words, so as you know, the way we talk about existential risk in cosmogonic humanism is we talk about existential risk as being rooted not in the surface generator functions of existential risk, right? Win, lose, metrics, rivals, conflict, which generates fragile systems. Those are the two surface generator functions, but in a deeper root cause, which is a global intimacy disorder, right? So, and the source of that intimacy disorder is the same source that happens in any relationship, which is a failure to live in a shared story. But a shared story is not a postmodern conjecture made up story. It's a shared story of value rooted in first principles and first values, meaning a shared grammar of value, right? And so an evolutionary relationship requires, right, a shared grammar of value. And if there's no shared grammar of value, right, we can't have an evolutionary relationship. But again, I want to bracket that for a second, come back to it, and just go back to this, to the seriousness and the play, and those two together. So I don't know if you remember, and I don't know if Umberto Eco is on your reading list, but he wrote this great book called In the Name of the Rose, right? And there's a monastery in the medieval period, which is kind of very serious and on mission. And then, you know, friars and monks keep dying and they're poisoned. And so they're not sure, you know, who, what happened, who poisoned them. I think it was Sean Connery who played the major figure. I can see his face before me now. But basically what happens in the book, they did a movie of it, the book's much better. What basically happens is they're able to figure out that the rector of the monastery, right, poisoned the page in Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics that talks about laughter and humor. Because he thought, right? So every time someone goes, they turn the page. So anyone who goes to that page, right, kind of trying to access that laughter, right, gets poisoned. And of course, the rector was very serious. He was on mission, right? You know, he wanted to, right? And he said, you know, this is serious, right? We got to be in gravitas here. We can't be, you know, lost in the devil's laughter. And that, of course, is what the mystics are pointing to as being highly dangerous, right? Destructive, right? And ultimately debilitating, right? Yoshev b'shamayin yischak, right? The psalmist says, right? God sits, right? Divinity, she sits and laughs. Right? And in the book of creation, which is the 450-word original text of the Hebrew interior sciences, the highest quality of the 12 qualities of divinity is laughter. And our highest quality is laughter. Because laughter is not frivolous. Laughter is what holds paradox. right? All right, laughter is what nullifies the kind of the vagaries of human pomposity, right? You know, when the president slips on a banana peel, all of a sudden the president seems a little more relaxed. So we have to hold full dignity, full gravitas, right? The full sense of being, you know, everything's on the line. And yet at the very same moment, right, a kind of spacious, open laughter, right? And to be able to create an evolutionary spirituality that holds both of those, that both takes itself enormously seriously, that holds the core certainties of reality with enormous gravitas, and at the same time, dances in the uncertainty, bows before the mystery, right? Is devoted, right, to the kind of the unfolding and the unknown. If we can hold those together, because in some sense, brother, you know, pre-modernity and modernity focused on its core certainties. Post-modernity said, whoa, that's right, you guys just destroyed worlds hiding behind power moves, focused on your core certainties. Let's focus on the uncertainty. There is no grand narrative. The only grand narrative is there's no grand narrative, right? Uncertainty. So now in this new moment, this post-postmodern moment that you and I are so, and all of us are so committed to articulating, we need to dance between certainty and uncertainty, between radical gravitas and purpose and the mystery. And that allows us to be in full laughter and in full seriousness at the same time. So I think that's the context of an evolutionary relationship. The context of a relationship, before we talk about the substance of it, is this kind of radical joy, right? This breathing into the uncertainty. You and I can't love each other unless we can hold the uncertainty together. And there's an enormous fragility and uncertainty, right? You know, that we just don't know. And there's a kind of an epistemic humility that we hold. And yet at the same time, we're madly committed to the absolute integrity and core certainty of what we do know, because there's things that we know and that matter. And there's shared principles of value. There's a shared grammar of value. And I think just to cast this, to feel this particular cast today as a kind of the context of evolutionary spirituality, this dialectical joy that comes from certainty and uncertainty, from play and curiosity, right? You talked about curiosity in the beginning, together with radical purpose and direction, right? That's the plot line, if you will, of the shared story of value that we're in together. So just get that on the table, and maybe just offer a model then back to you, right? And you know what, we can maybe play with this together a little bit, brother, right? Which is, I love the distinction you made, and I wanted to get to the second part of what you said in the big opening piece. I want to get back to
Let me just respond briefly to
you. Go, please, with delight.
In terms of this leap from modernity to postmodernity, taking this next step. And of course, you and I have devoted most of our adult lives to investigating the question of what would it mean to take that next step. A lot of people are trying to figure it out. A lot of people have different ideas about it. But one of the principal developmental capacities, it seems essential in taking the next step beyond the postmodern predicament, is the capacity to marry, as you've been describing and we've been speaking about, profound curiosity, which means deep interest in the nature of things and in the truth of the nature of things, and simultaneously cultivating the spiritual capacity to embrace radical uncertainty. Because certainty gives human beings a feeling of security. I know, that makes people feel safe, makes them feel right, and makes them feel protected. But as you have pointed out many times, as we evolve, we start discovering that, you know, reality is not as simple as I thought it would, as I thought it was. And the answers to complex and important questions and ultimate questions don't tend to be black and white. They tend to be complex and often, as you said, paradoxical.
Right.
So the challenge as we consciously evolve, is to learn how to be able to embrace paradox, complexity and paradox from a place of spiritual self-confidence.
Right.
when you spoke about the joy before, you know, the nature, and I'm a spiritual teacher I met in Holland a long time ago said, Andrew, enlightenment is lightness of being. The one of the clear telltale signs of enlightened awareness is the presence and the manifestation of lightness of being in the enlightened one. So what you said is very true, that with higher development, lightness of being would be part of it, would be the expression of a natural state.
Beautiful.
And that natural state would be accompanied by what I was just describing, with a deeper and more profound capacity to embrace paradox without fear, without intimidation.
Right.
And to remain curious about what's ultimately true, even when it becomes so complex and so confusing that one it feels intellectually, morally, sometimes spiritually overwhelmed. One stays present and doesn't back down. One stays awake and very focused.
Yeah, and this is so important. What does this person feel like? What does the evolutionary enlightened person feel like? That's what we're describing, right? What are their qualities? What are their characteristics? Right.
Well, a combination of very insecure and very secure.
right. And it's exactly that, right? In other words, it's exactly that. You know, that kind of radical fragility, but not the kind of, I remember, and then I'm gonna kind of be rigorous for a second, because I want to get back to the first part of what you said earlier, because which is our topic, but you have, in the best sense, you know, it seduced me to say one more sentence about this, because it's so important what you said. And I remember, brother, when I first started teaching, you know, which is more years ago than I want to remember, right? It was actually like 41 years ago. That's kind of intense, right? Right, it was like, you know, and it was the beginning of teaching. And I ran into someone who's a very, very good teacher. And I just finished giving a talk. And he said, wow, there was so much you were certain about in that. I don't have any certainties. I just teach my uncertainties. Oh, right? Right. Which was both beautiful, but also completely non-dialectical, right? In other words, actually, you have to teach your core certainties and your uncertainties at the same time, right? Because that's actually who we are. We're both radically secure. We actually know things, right? There's a reason that Maimonides and Aquinas, they weren't wrong when they said, right, you can know the divine, and there's a way to actually transcend Kant, right? The great Kantian modern revolution, which says you can only know, you know, phenomena, but never noumena. You never know essence at all. That's only through the eye of the mind. When you actually open the eye of contemplation, or the eye of the heart, right? I called it in a recent essay we're just finished called the eye of consciousness, right? When you open the eye of consciousness, you actually transcend Kant, and you have a direct access, unmediated taste. You literally taste, right? And you and I have been blessed, right, to actually experience that taste, and it's more real than anything else that you know. So kind of, in a certain sense, postmodernity has kind of waged a battle in the politics of the real, right, to disqualify that knowing. And in that knowing, the characteristic of the knowing is exactly what you and I are talking about, the ability to hold paradox, right? And there's actually that precise ability. But now I'm gonna, with permission, I'm gonna wrench us back, but in a good and a sweet wrench. I was thinking about a wrench because I was thinking about my back still, just in case you guys were losing empathy, anybody, right? So let's talk about evolutionary relationships. I wanna offer a distinction, brother. Right, and it's one that, you know, we've mentioned briefly in the past, and I think it's really, really helpful, because reality's relationship, reality's evolution, reality's the evolution of relationships. So let me just put one more sentence into that. And what causes the evolution of relationships? So two things. One is the inherent movement of evolution itself. It's the ceaseless creativity, the inherent impulse, the evolutionary impulse itself. But two is crisis. Crisis is an evolutionary driver. And in all crisis is a crisis of relationship, right? All crisis is a crisis of intimacy, right? Crisis always, in one way or the other, is a crisis of relationship, a crisis of intimacy. And the response to the crisis of intimacy, the crisis of relationship, is the evolution of relationships. So I just want to chart for a second, and I'm sure you'll have a lot to say about it and refine it or deepen it or agree or disagree, but let me see if I can throw it on the table. And I think it's deep in alignment with what you were saying. And it'll give us a frame for it, which is, in this modern moment, last the kind of deal of culture of the last 100,000 years has been broken, right? The deal of the last 100,000 years in relationships was the man is the protector, right? The hunter, right? The woman, right? Gathers, nurtures, right? Homemakes. And that's the kind of evolutionary deal. That deal is broken, right? With the evolution of women in the marketplace, the emergence of the feminine in America, there's a huge ascendancy, for example, of women, right? And a kind of, right? Men are actually getting, you know, destroyed and undone. You know, my friend Warren Farrell has written about this at length, right? You know, people like Jordan Peterson are speaking to that male audience that can't find itself because the old structures aren't holding it, right? And the old notions don't work. So the old notions were built on, you know, what you might want to call roommates. We were roommates, right? The man had a role, the woman had a role. Relationship was built on this roommate model in which each did, right? The woman did what she did in getting pregnant, having children. The man protected, right? And led in a certain way. The woman was devotional. There was a private dance of love if there was roommates. And along comes modernity, and modernity says, no, that's not enough. And modernity is the last 800-900 years. Right, although there were lots of expressions of it earlier in culture. Culture's not linear in that sense. David Graeber's not wrong in his book, you know, The Dawn of Everything, right? And it's not an evolutionary line. Evolution's much more complex. That's a different conversation I'd love to have with you. Right. But in any case, right, there's moments of it, but in the last 100 years, right, 1,000 years, excuse me, there's a clear move from role mate, right, which just goes exponential in the last 50 years, to soulmate. Right, so we're, you know, we're in 1963, right? You and I are, you know, we're a year old or whatever it is. We're just getting started, right? And Fiddler on the Roof appears on Broadway, right? And, you know, Tevye and Goldie. Tevye sings to Goldie, do you love me? Right? And she says, for 25 years, I've washed your clothes. I've darned your clothes. And she goes through all the things she does for him. So what are you asking me? Do you love me? But he says, no, I get that, but do you love me? Right? And what he's saying is the old contract of roommate, right? We need something new. And soulmate comes to play. Right? There's this new notion of soulmate in 1970. I don't know if you remember it, Ally McGraw, Ryan O'Neill love story, right? It's the ultimate soulmate movie, right? And soulmate is now we have shared roles, although that's also true, but we're looking deeply in each other's eyes. We love each other deeply, and we share our vulnerability, and we share our wounding, right? And we hold each other in the way that roommates didn't have time for. But what we've come to realize is that that's beautiful. It's an evolutionary leap. There's an evolution of relationships from roommate to soulmate. But brother, what you're describing is, right, and I think what we both independently found and articulated is that soulmate doesn't take you home. There's a certain point at which looking deeply in each other's eyes without a shared vision, right, actually hurts your eyes, right? And it becomes narcissistic. It becomes self-involved. It becomes self-absorbed and wounding. And so then there's this new model, which I've called wholemates. You know, and wholemates means we go from roommate to soulmate to wholemate. Wholemate means evolutionary relationship. Right. And actually, Barbara and I wrote the draft of a book that we're hopefully going to publish this year, which was called Evolutionary Relationships. We changed the title to The Future of Relationships from Roommate to Soulmate to Homemate. But it's about homemate. And homemate is very close to what you describe as evolutionary relationship. So I love the kind of that, which makes perfect. And a homemate says we're each whole by ourselves and yet not whole. And we're living together for the sake of the whole. Right. We're living in an evolutionary context. Right, for the sake of the whole, right? And our relationship is based on this deep sense of devotion for the sake of the whole. And I'll close with this, and I'd love to talk in terms of distinguishing evolutionary relationships from other ones, right? But here's a model for it. You remember our friend Lana Wachowski, right? Who, you know, back that Ken introduced him into our circles. And, you know, Lana makes this movie, and I remember spending, you know, a lot of time talking to him about it, makes this movie, The Matrix, and The Matrix, which just had another rerun, Matrix, you know, number 4, is about law, you know, is about Neo and Trinity. And Neo and Trinity love each other deeply, they're soulmates. When she's dying in his arms, she's remembering their kiss, but then she says to him, you got to fulfill the mission. Right? And as Neo and Trinity, when they meet each other, right, they say, why do we meet? Because we were asking the same question. And the three great questions with which we started. So I think, maybe, we, you know, if you're up for it, we could focus on this, that there's a new kind of relationship, and that we there's a certain heresy that we're both saying, I think. And the heresy is that soulmates is beautiful and necessary. You can't live without a soulmate, but it's insufficient, right? It actually dies unless soulmate becomes, in some sense, also wholemate, which is what we can call evolutionary relationship. So something like that. I wanted to get that out.
I agree, beautifully said. I agree with every word. So I'll just go over a little bit of the same territory. So first of all, an evolutionary relationship, as I understand it, in an enlightenment context or an evolutionary enlightenment context, would be based upon the individual and shared revelation that God is evolution and evolution is God. That the absolute principle that created the universe and is creating the universe is the evolving universe. And the evolving universe is on a journey of becoming. When I experience the evolutionary impulses, the urge to become more conscious, and you experience the evolutionary impulses, the urge to become more conscious, we've individually and collectively realized that when I experience the urge to become more conscious and you experience the urge to become more conscious, we recognize in a moment of profound revelation that it's not me who wants to become more conscious. It's the energy and intelligence that created the universe aspiring to become more conscious through me and us. So then my yearning for and my love of God of the absolute, and your yearning of and love of God of the absolute is God's loving herself through us.
Right.
And a profound manifestation and expression of the love of God in an evolutionary interpretive framework is the desire to become more of who and what she and we can be. So this shared recognition completely recontextualizes in a very similar way to what you were describing the context for the human relatedness, because now there's a shared recognition of a cosmic identity. Excuse me.
Who am I, right? In other words, that's the who am I question.
That looks like Mark and it looks like Andrew, but it's really the energy and intelligence that created the universe, awakening to itself and engaging itself through the body, mind, personality of Mark and the body, mind, personality of Andrew. And when she knows that's the case, it's one thing, but when Mark and Andrew recognize that that's the case, their evolutionarily infused, inspired, awakened relationship lights up with that shared knowledge, which evolutionarily empowers their being together. So now their being together has the spark of the absolute being with itself. But the absolute being with itself in an evolutionary context is the absolute aspiring to become more of what she can be and what she's capable of. And what we've discovered with evolutionary theory is that for the universe to be able to evolve the level of consciousness or the level of its own deepest interiority, it seems that there needs to be conscious intention, conscious cooperation, the constant conscious willingness to compel consciousness to evolve through us, because it will not happen by itself. And in that recognition, there's the discovery that, oh, I see. At the highest level, this is why I exist. This is why Mark exists. This is why Andrew exists, so that the universe can become more conscious of itself through the choices I make and the actions we take. So in a situation like this, our relationship becomes all and only about the evolution of God as evolution.
Yeah.
And as I said before, there's a profound moral imperative inherent in that. One more thing I wanted to add to this,
please.
Which is that, and this is the foundation. This is the foundation of our first principle of evolutionary enlightenment. Which is the question: is when God created the universe and something came from nothing, was the Big Bang a big yes, a big no, or a big neutral?
Right.
And so what Western materialistic science would tell us, it's a big neutral. Doesn't mean anything. There's no purpose, there's no rhyme, there's no reason. which means Mark is a random accident, as is Andrew is a random accident. If Mark thinks he's a random accident, and if Andrew thinks he's a random accident, then their relationship is going to be two random accidents in progress, which is pretty dreary and nihilistic. The shadow of some of the outdated theories of a lot of the great religious traditions is that where the action is, where liberation, joy, and true love is to be found, is not in the world, not in the body, but beyond the world and beyond the body. Right. In some beautiful, wonderful place that if we live a moral life, we get to experience once we die. So the implications of this kind of position is that the world and the human experience is something we want to get out of and get away from, transcend as soon as possible. And so we could extrapolate from that position in relation to life is a big no.
Right.
But of course, when we awaken to evolution and we experience it literally physically, when we awaken to the evolutionary impulse as a biological impulse, as a sexual impulse, as the urge towards creativity and as the urge towards consciousness, we experience that it is the experience of pure and unbridled developmental ecstasy. And it's all, and when we awaken to that state of consciousness, I call it the authentic self, we call it the unique self, the presence, the vibration of the unique self and of the authentic self is one big screaming, overwhelming, non-dual yes. Yes is the foundation of reality, of all of reality, including all the pain and suffering. And that's part and parcel of manifest reality. So when I have experienced as much as what I just described and embraced it, and you have experienced everything I've described and embraced it, that means our relationship then ideally should become an expression of that yes. That's now, because you're an imperfect human being and I'm an imperfect human being, we will imperfectly express that yes, but endeavoring to wholeheartedly, radically, and unselfconsciously express and manifest that yes as our relationship, which should be a creative explosion in motion, would be the moral obligation that we consciously embrace for eternity together.
Right. I mean, gorgeous, right? And I mean, it's so, I agree with every word you said, right? And we're really, it's a place where we're just, you know, it comes together so beautifully. I'm so excited to be in this conversation. And I can't, you know, just to be a little bit audacious, I can't sufficiently emphasize the importance of this conversation. Is why I didn't want to miss it. This is not like, oh, got some gig, let's show up for it. This is the most important conversation that we could possibly be having, right? And the entire world.
Now more than ever.
Now more than ever. This is the conversation. I mean, the entire enterprise of psychology, which is the great modern enterprise, right, is with all of its very important contributions, which are critical, and each one has a place in the 11 schools of psychology, all address different forms of pathology, and those are all critically important. We need them, and yet psychology by itself can't take us home if it doesn't actually talk about these questions of who are you, and where are you, and where you're going. And if you don't have, right, a context for relationship, which is a shared story of value in which you are in some sense wholemates and you're in some sense an evolutionary relationship, then there's no possible way, right, that random accidents who develop egoic structures can actually, now individual relationships can. There's lots of people who have had no shared value structure, who were ethical, beautiful people and developed individual great relationships here and there. But we're talking about a democratization. We're talking about a world in which we're unbearably intimate with each other, and we need a democratization of relationship. We need a democratization of value, and we need a world in which 8 billion people are actually moving from this kind of broken Homo sapien with this broken relationship, you know, structure, which is the source of the extraction model that generates existential risk, to actually an up level to a kind of new human and new humanity. And you can't have a new human and new humanity unless we have a new vision of relationship. And if I don't get, you know, as you said, I'll say it in slightly different words, but the same thing. And I'm so excited to be talking about this with you. If you don't get that, when Andrew becomes Andrew, when Daniela becomes Daniela, when Krista becomes Krista, when Mark becomes Mark, there's a shudder of self-recognition in the infinite, right? That never existed before. and that I'm actually an individuation of the infinite field that's needed by the entire field. And that when I come in a relationship with you, so when Mark and Andrew are in a relationship, right, it's not a win-lose metrics, but it's also not a pragmatic alliance, right? It's two qualities of intimacy that reality worked very hard to bring together, right? And reality didn't stop being intelligent. Reality worked very hard to create this context and this relationship and this new quality of intimacy that's now needed, right, by the whole system, and that the joy that we have, right, and together, the quality that's Andrew and the quality that's Mark, creating a new quality of intimacy that never existed before, that's in service of the whole, filled with curiosity and play, right, and gravitas and joy and purpose, right?
There's paradox. A paradox.
And paradox, and holding the paradox of the whole thing, because any two is a paradox, right? Twos are a paradox. That's what twos are. So without that, the entire context of relationship breaks down, and the fullness of eros that comes from relationship is denuded, and then the human being experiences an unbearable emptiness, and that unbearable emptiness has to be covered up, and we cover it up by pseudo-eros, and pseudo-eros begins, right, all of the exponential growth curves and madnesses, right, of crowds and individuals, right, that cause existential risk. So this is not casual. This is not, isn't this an interesting structure? Actually, relationship doesn't work, right? If it's merely random accident, separate selves. If there's not a sense of what you call authentic self, or what I call unique self, or evolutionary unique selves coming together, if we can't answer the question of who are you, we can't actually create relationship, and evolution stalls. And when evolution stalls, it doesn't just meander. At a time of exponential risk, right, you know, our friend Michael Murphy, Michael used to say evolution meanders. And Michael and I used to get together for drinks for a couple of years and just kind of talk after we did dialogues. And Michael said, you know, evolution is not linear, it meanders. That's no longer true. Right? And Michael got it wrong. Right? Michael at Esalen, you know, and I say this, Michael, if you're watching with mad delight and love, Michael would always say to me at Esalen, right, we can't have a universal grammar of value. No one can capture the flag. So Esalen was this weird unevenness between really deep and great seminars and just utter nonsense. And it didn't matter because no one could capture the flag and everyone could teach what they wanted. And I said to Michael, you don't understand existential risk. You don't actually, you're in an old world. You're rebelling against, you know, kind of the old dogmas of modernity, and you're actually lost. You're trapped. As much as you're doing Aurobindo in a postmodern moment, if no one can capture the flag, there's no grammar of value. And I remember at my last lunch with him, Andrew, my last lunch with Michael, he said, you know what? Right, you're right. You know, and it's the era of don't capture the flag is over. We were right then. But the first time it dawned on him, right, that it's actually, that's not going to work. We need a shared grammar of value as a context for our diversity. Sure. I'm going to get that last sentence and I'll throw it back to you. A shared grammar of value is not totalitarian and impositional, right? It's our very identity that we share. And a shared grammar of value is a context for diversity. And a relationship must participate in a shared grammar of value, whether it's collectively, right, or individually. And that's a context for diversity. It's a context for all of the gorgeous individuation of irreducible uniqueness. And without this, the whole thing breaks down. To you, brother.
No, I agree 100%. That's beautiful. And it's obviously completely essential for us to take this leap beyond postmodernity. But so many of the thousands of people that have begun to take that leap beyond postmodernity would seem, to my imperfect vision, to be very far away from what you just suggested. But one thing I wanted to answer, one thing I wanted to respond to in terms of what you're saying about the therapeutic context, and I was thinking about this today, that without the healing, without the cosmic healing that occurs within us at a soul level. When we awaken to the truth of evolution, which is that when God created the universe, it was a big yes. That the existence of the universe, of the creative process, is a big yes in motion. When we experience that yes as a living metaphysical absolute reality, vibrating, pulsating in our cells, in our soul, in our heart, in our mind, in our body, we know that God is good, that to exist is good, that life is good, in spite of all the pain and suffering and paradoxes and contradictions. We know that existence is good. But when you know it, not intellectually, but you experience it as an absolute metaphysical truth, I believe, this is my personal opinion, that only it's only within that context that we can face and come to terms with whatever personal knots there still are in our soul that need to be untied. Because if you try and untie those knots, and the untying of those knots is not being held within the revelation of absolute love,
right,
and the recognition of the absolute goodness of existence, I don't think it'll have the power to heal us. But the awakening to the unique self, the authentic self, can do that immediately and directly, and provide a foundation for dealing with all the complexity and paradoxes that we need to. I have a feeling we should probably try and take some questions because we only have a half hour left.
Okay, no, great, great. I mean, this is like great. This is just getting started. This conversation. This is such a great and important and necessary conversation. And we'll take questions, and maybe in the context of questions, we'll be able to talk about that last thing you just said, which is you can't heal anything without the radical context. And I agree wholeheartedly and articulate it with you of the absolute goodness of reality, right? The absolute yes.
Right?
The absolute yes. Amen.
As a lived experience, not just an intellectual.
As an utter and absolute lived experience. Yes. Yes, yes, brother. What a delight. What a delight.
Delightful. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it.
You're demonstrating spirit over matter.
Amen. Amen. I'm actually just delighted to be here. I'm delighted to be here. We're 1,000,000,000%, and it's the healing of relationship, right? In other words, of just being in the space together, right, is the most gorgeous thing. How are we doing questions? Is Danielle or Krista?
Yeah, we don't have yet any questions, but please write your questions in the chat box if you have any for Andrew or for Mark or for both of them.
Right, and I might, with permission, everyone, I'm going to suggest, right, just that we do maybe like, Andrew, you can go on. I'm kind of at my edge here. So maybe we'll do like a couple of questions, and I'm probably going to kind of gentle out. Sure. I'm probably gentle out.
Sure. No, whatever. You just go as long as you feel up for it, and when you've had enough.
No, thank you. Thank you. Let's take a couple of questions if there are any, or elucidate a couple last. You know, we'll wrap.
But you know, if there aren't any questions, it means we did a good job.
That's fantastic.
The questionless state is when the intellect has been slayed.
Well, there is a first question here from Krista, actually. And she is asking, what does this mean for the future of personal human relationships? How does this relate to polyamory, monogamy, and celibacy?
Well, there's a small question, right? there's a small question. Andrew, you want to dive into that a little bit? That's a big question.
Well, Chris, I've lived my love life rather conservatively, so I don't know the answer to the question. I know that as our identity grows and becomes more inclusive, it demands that we question a lot of our culturally conditioned ways of thinking and believing and our moral habits. So from my perspective, the spiritual awakening, the awakening to enlightened awareness, is inherently countercultural, but there's a big part of enlightened awareness is it helps us to see how we're more programmed like robots. And very few people think their own thoughts, very few people think for themselves about anything. And we're frightfully, painfully afraid to think for ourselves about big questions. So it would make sense to me that the more we are able to liberate ourselves from the prison of conditioned ways of thinking about being human, which includes sexuality, it could mean all kinds of things, you know. And I think we're going to find out the answer to that question. The other day, I don't know what the future is going to look like. But I spoke to a student of mine, or a former student of mine, the other day, who had just been in one relationship, and he broke up for certain reasons within that relationship, and then he quickly got into another relationship with apparently a very attractive woman who was into polyamory. And he found her polyamorous, direction. So something that he felt he couldn't handle. I said, why did you get into a relationship with him? Because he found it very compelling, very appealing, and thought he could handle it. So I said, what did you do that for? You're gonna get hurt. You shouldn't do something that you don't feel, especially in relationship to sexuality, that you feel comfortable with. So I mean, I don't know the answer to the question. Sex is a very complex subject, and maybe we could talk about it more in detail sometime. But I think the future is wide open, and especially with the current fluctuations of people's relationship to the gender consciousness and sexual identity. I think it's almost unimaginable where we're going. I'm a little afraid to think about it sometimes, but I think it's a wide open field. But I think the most important thing is that, what's the context in which we think about sexuality? Do we think about the context in sexuality as an experience? Do we want to, as an experience we want to have for ourselves? Or is it a part of life in which we want to be free? Because in the way that I look at the spiritual life is the pursuit of unconditional freedom. And we don't want to do anything that would inhibit our freedom, our inner freedom and our inner sense of self-confidence. And just to finish, last thing, is that I continue to find, after teaching for 30 years, that living the truth that we discover when we wake up is walking the razor's edge. And so we have to be very careful and very cautious and always make the most appropriate choices if we're not going to hurt ourselves or anybody else. So no easy answers, but the future is wide open.
Yeah, no, it's... And maybe this could be, and maybe we should even do, you know, a part two of a dialogue in general, right, on, you know, the second part of evolutionary relationships, you know, because we've set a context here, but maybe the most wonderful and important thing to say is that, let's take monogamy and polyamory. The essential question is not monogamy or polyamory, which is, it's a question in a very, very deep conversation. Right, and there's a third possibility, which is monogamous polyamory, right?
And, I've heard about that.
Right. Which, what does that mean? Right.
That sounds like a contradiction.
Right. Or is it a contradiction? Is it a paradox? Right. Another. So I wrote an unpublished essay on monogamous polyamory. Right. Celibacy, I think, is actually quite important. Right. At different stages of life. So let me bracket that for a second and say it a little differently. The deeper question is, am I in a roommate relationship? Am I in a soulmate relationship, or am I in an evolutionary relationship?
Very good.
Homemates. That's the question. In other words, and what we tend to do is we tend to do what we might call, a level line fallacy. In other words, what we do is when we compare things, we compare, let's say, the best monogamy, right? So, you know, classical best monogamy, right? You know, two people, five children, all the most ethical, kind people you can imagine, right? Surrounded by another 17 grandchildren, all running charitable organizations, right? For the sake of goodness, right? And, you know, and polyamory is some sleazy couple in Haight-Ashbury who are just, you know, using polyamory as an excuse for kind of, you know, gratification in ways that are not sacred. And they just call it polyamory. And, you know, my son's mother, Mariana, wrote a great play called Zen Boyfriends, which, you know, went around San Francisco. You know, last time they did it was a couple of years ago. And Zen Boyfriends was about this version of polyamory. And people compare them and they say, oh, monogamy is fantastic, polyamory is terrible. But of course, that's inaccurate. What we've just done is we've looked at the ultimate view of one, and we do that often in religion, right? Jews coming out of Judaism, right, who grew up in kind of bar mitzvah world, a lot of bar, not so much mitzvah. Then they go kind of east. And they see these beautiful kind of, you know, the best of Eastern religion. They say, wow, that's great. My Jewish thing, that sucks, right? But of course, the reverse is true, right? You could go for the corrupt forms of Eastern and the best forms of Hebrew mysticism. You can't do level line fallacies. You actually have to look at each one. How does it work, right, in its best? How does it work in its middle? How does it work in its worst? And what's the best possibility for most people most of the time? Which is not necessarily the only possibility for all people all the time, number two. And number three, at different stages of life, right? Different might apply, right? So you might be madly committed to a certain kind of ethical polyamory at a certain stage, and then at a later stage, you're actually complete with it, right? Or the reverse, right? So, but putting all that aside, right? You know, and I'd love to do a dialogue on evolutionary sexuality. It's a great idea. And evolutionary relationships in that context, which is, it's wildly important. So it's thrilled that you put it in the space. But I'd say for the sake of this dialogue, and I'm going to, and again, and thank you all for, you know, holding me, and thank you particularly, Andrew, for being so delightful to talk to and to engage with, that for at least in a little moments, the pain disappeared, right? Which is
beautiful.
Yeah, which is gorgeous, right? Just like gone. So now that we're not talking anymore, it's coming back. So I'm going to sign off. I'm going to sign off after this. But I would just say, for the sake of this conversation, I think, and Andrew will get the he'll give us the final word. I open and he'll close us, I hope, right? But that roommate, soulmate, homemade, or kind of evolutionary relationships versus non-evolutionary relationships, are actually the more important question, right? And the focus is on monogamy, polyamory, really? Yawn. Detail, board, right? You know, although, and it's a great question. It's great that you put it into the space, and it's a necessary question. And I'd love to do a dialogue on it. But I'd say the context for that important question, right?
I would be happy to participate in this communication in the future. Please keep.
Yeah, totally. Totally. Absolutely. Absolutely. With delight. But the if we can lay down this context that, you know, my monogamy is transformed by being in an evolutionary relationship, and my polyamory, if that's my path, is transformed. And here's the thing, and my celibacy is transformed, right? In other words, if my celibacy is not an evolutionary relationship to life, you get some of the tragedies of the Catholic Church, where celibacy becomes the entire focus, but you actually, the evolutionary relationship actually disappears. I think it's a great inquiry. And Andrew, I could not have been more delighted to be with you. And thank you for the healing balm of our friendship, which went right into my back, right? And everybody, thank you so, so much, right? Andrew, what a delight, brother. Thank you.
Thank you. Feel better.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you. Thank you,
Chris. Get better soon.
Everybody. Yay.
Thank you, everybody.
Would you?
Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you if you wanted to take one or two more questions, or if you want to take one.
Take one.
So, one question is from Michael. He is asking, how does one with too much feelings and empathy balance life?
With too much what?
Feelings and empathy.
Too many emotions and empathy? Balanced life.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the great thing about meditation is that it teaches you how to disidentify with the mind and disidentify with your emotions. So I would, if you're too emotional and if you're overwhelmed by your feelings and you're too emotional, you need to learn how to bear witness to them and not be such a slave to them. And I'm sure you've heard that said 1,000 times, but it's really worth doing. So you have to learn how to spend long periods of time sitting very still, not less than an hour at a time, disidentifying with thought and with feeling, and just paying attention and having no relationship to them. If you can learn how have no relationship with your mind for a period of time, with your emotions for a period of time, I promise you that sooner or later you're going to discover space. And in that space, you're going to discover a natural and inherent joy and sense of balance, a deep sense of well-being, centeredness, fearlessness, ease of being, a measure of objectivity, and relief from the tyranny of the mind and emotions. But you got to work for it. If you want to be a sane, happy, balanced, centered person, you got to work for it. It doesn't come for free. And so you have to practice, and you have to do it seriously, and you have to be committed, and you have to be willing to suffer through the chaos of the confusion of a chaotic mind and a chaotic emotional body. You have to be willing to suffer through it and not react to it. for long periods of time. And if you have the commitment to do that and you stick to it till the end and you don't stop, the beautiful relief and release that I described will happen. It's not a matter of if, it's just a matter of when. It might happen very quickly. It might take longer, but it will happen. But you got to do the hard work. And these days, everything happens. these days, everybody wants instant enlightenment, instant relief, instant healing. It doesn't really work that way. Happiness, inner freedom, sanity, and spiritual self-confidence is something that is worth fighting for. It's something we have to be willing to fight for with everything we've got, with our souls and with our hearts. But if we're willing to do it, we will succeed. And then we can be exemplars for other people. Hope that answers your question. Should I take one more on this, the last one, Daniela?
One more, last one, yep.
Okay.
Are paradoxes meant to be resolved or to hold the tension of opposites?
To hold the tension of opposites. And to live in that tension, because in that tension, that the tension in it that we hold within paradox is what's called the liminal space. And it's in that liminal space where, as yet, unmanifest information and perspectives can be found. And there's new information, new perspectives that emerge in the liminal space, are an endless source of revelation. There's a lot of questions I have that I'm trying to answer and I feel are important that I need to answer for my own ongoing development. And in order to do that, I try and spend as much time as I can in that space right in the middle of paradox between knowing and not knowing. And when I do that, I can feel a developmental tension. And the stronger the developmental tension becomes, the more I begin to glimpse beyond duality and beyond polarity and beyond paradox. And that's the most important thing. So as Mark and I were speaking about earlier in the talk, we have to be very careful about being right about knowing the truth, because except for God realization, I got to be careful saying that, except for enlightenment itself, all truth is relative. So we have to be careful about our convictions, about what we feel very strongly about, because the ego gets all hung up on being right. And gets a feeling of being very empowered by being right, but needing to see ourselves as being right is what creates is the source of all the confusion. So if we can seek to understand what the truth is and learn and seek for the truth, embrace more and more paradox, we will become wise and enlightened men and women. And it requires a lot of guts, it requires a lot of confidence, not to be sure, not to need to be sure. I want to know the truth. I want to know what's true, but I don't need to be absolutely sure. We want to learn how to be able to leave a lot of space around truth and be more interested in the truth than we are in anything else, and always willing to never be absolutely sure. What I mean by that is if something's very clear, you can be 99% sure. But to leave at least 1% out of the 99, which is room for what you may have missed or what's not apparent to you, that actually exists. And when you can embrace the discipline of not being sure, you will continue to evolve and you won't get stuck. Thank you, everybody. It's been a privilege. And
thank
pleasure.
You, Andrew.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
And we will announce the next dialogue via email. We are not yet quite sure when it will happen, but you all will get the emails and the announcements. And I hope to see you next time. Thank you so much.
A bit louder if possible. Okay.